lecturer two in 1985, having obtained the Master of Laws LLM degree from the same faculty in 1984. He was a Fulbright scholar at the University of California, Los Angeles in 1990 and was called to the State Bar of California, USA in 1991. Professor Edward Oyelowo was promoted to the rank of a professor of law in 2005 with effect from 2002. He is a fellow of the Nigerian Chartered Institute of Arbitrators and the Chartered Institute of Taxation. Professor Oyewo also serves as a technical partner stroke consultant in the law firm of PAC Solicitors. He came to know the Lord Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior in 1986 under the ministration of the Reverend Shola Awolinde in New Estate Baptist Church, and he served as a member of the church before moving with his home fellowship group to establish the New Heritage Baptist Church Shomolu as a pioneer member. He has served as a member of the diaconate and chairman of the diaconate of New Heritage Baptist Church Shomolu. He has been married now for more than 3 decades to his sweetheart, Olukemi Abisola Oyewo, and the marriage is blessed with 3 children. Torera, Toby, and Timmy. Amen. We glorify God for the life of our brother. It is with great pleasure that I have the honor today to invite our guest lecturer, Professor Oyelowo, to the microphone as he brings unto us that which the Lord has laid in his heart to do. Please, will you stand as we receive our brother? Put your hands together. Thank you very much.
Please be seated. I would like the choir to join me in this song. Ancient world, ever true, changing me and changing you, we have come with open arms. Oh, let the ancient world impart. Can you start properly?
Ancient world, ever true.
Because, you know, it's documented that my set, the set I went through in Ife, is documented in our law reports that we had a case of examination malpractice. It's reported, and it went to the Supreme Court in the case of Akitemi against Omechini. And what happened? There was Expo, and unfortunately, There were some people, if you are not principled, you know, one of the things you must do from young, it was Shakespeare that taught me, to thy own self be true. And we had a study group, and our study group was hot. So we were targeted by some, you know, colleagues of ours, ladies, to come and please teach them this, teach them that. And when they brought the question in our study group, the topics were not even things we were preparing for. So we said, where did you get this question? It's strange, because these topics were not covered in this session. As a student, you know, it's difficult to study what was covered in the session. Talk less of something that was not covered. So, for those of us who were a bit, you know, principled, because we're not born again at that time, in fact, my mind would not even accept going to read those things, because it was a day before the exam. Something I've not read all through the semester, all through the session. A day before the exam, you want me to read it? I said, no. We said, no. But some of us, one of my very good friends, you know, he was sharing quarters with those people. So after we all left, they went to meet him in his quarters. And they took the books and wrote it down, and they taught. And the long and short of it, they had A's in that course. And our Law Student Society president, who is a senior advocate of Nigeria now, took up the responsibility to petition against the lecturers and to say that there was examination malpractice. And the university investigated it and confirmed. How? It was simple. They just took the scripts, and when they look at the scripts, the normal student, because when the questions came out, three of them were supposed to do compulsory 6 questions. Three of them were not taught at all. I think what happened was that the lecturer had the intention of teaching it, but did not teach it. So he has set his examination and submitted it. So the rest of us were squeezed into the ones that he taught. And you just see somebody will get 18 over 25, 20 over 25. Then when it comes to those questions, it will be 5 over 25. 2 over 25, 3 over 25. And then there were some students, not only were they getting 20 over 25, in those ones that were taught, they were getting, in fact, 21 and 22 over 25. So they collected their scripts. And unfortunately, those in our study group who later taught them fell into that group. In fact, my friend I'm talking about now is a pastor. I thank God for his life. He's a pastor in the state of California and one of the biggest churches in, but he fell into that error. And when the examination investigation panel took those scripts, they immediately rusticated those students. Yeah. But you see, that is the beauty of being able to experience this and tell about it. Now, the ones that were boys took their penalty and served. The ones that were girls, they had seen the expo in several courses that they were on first class. Yeah. So they went to court, and that's how they came about. They won the battle, but they lost the war. They won the battle in the sense that in the excitement of the university to prosecute the misconduct and investigate it, they fell foul of the rules of fair hearing, which is a constitutional requirement, which also can be an impediment sometimes. But it is the right of every person to be given a fair hearing, as God gave fair hearing to Adam and Eve. So the court said they were wrongly, you know, rusticated. But the university refused to release their results. So they went to court another time. And this got to the Supreme Court. And at the Supreme Court said, the process for the award of certificates is not by passing exams only. but by a process determined by the university in the privilege of awarding his certificates. And we cannot compel the university on the circumstances to award the certificates. So they won the battle and lost the war. But the story didn't end there. Now these three students went abroad. And guess what? They had first class. They had first class. One of them had first class. The rest of them had 2-1. And in fact, one of them is so close to me, she also became born again. In fact, she works with the United Nations. But the question is, did they need to cheat? They had the brain, but the opportunity was there. And in all this, the lecturers were not sanctioned. So basically, examination or practice, when people engage in it, is not actually a reflection of their IQ. It's just a reflection of their moral or value system that makes them to compromise, that makes them want to achieve by any means other than the means that should come from them. So I always tell people, don't condemn anybody. I work with students and I enjoy working with them. Please always speak positive things to your children, because in them is that gifting that God has shown. There is nobody that God has created that has not given a gifting that will make him to fulfill the destiny of God upon his life. It is by speaking wrong things into the life of people. Ulushi, uludu. Why? Why must such words come from your mouth as a parent? So when we talk about examination or practice, the pre-examination is the deadliest. Then, of course, the one that we see is the examination or practice during. And please, here, I need you to give me the terminologies. What are the ones that you know? Yeah? Egun. Giraffe. Ramseros. Microchip. Livewire. CNN. You know CNN? That's when the school have captured the examiners and they come to broadcast the exam live. That's CNN. So the student will be copying. Yes, what other things we have? We have computer. When you have put it on your... nobody has told me about tattoo. Tattoo. When you use red and green biro so you can see sharply. On your laps. In fact, tattoo is the most dehumanizing thing that anybody can do to himself. Because when you are caught, your body parts become an exhibit. Yeah. Imagine you are a lady and you write something on your lap. Your lap becomes exhibit. Exhibit one, lap. Oyashi. You've thought less of yourself. As a human being, when you get to that point, it's terrible. So whatever form you take, we all know about it. And then after. In fact, the culprits are the parents. Because post-examination, malpractice is found that costs more money. So you go to JAMB, you go to WAEC, and you say you want the child to have 6 A's. They will tell you every A is 150. Yes, there are people who do it. As good as WAEC has been over the years, they still have people who cannot resist the temptation of making cheap money. And wherever they are caught, they are sanctioned, but the damage is done. So we have those who also sell their bodies to influence mass. Here, you find a lot of lecturers embarrassing themselves, because nowadays,
thank God for the social media. The young ladies have a way of trapping them, make them go naked, and they put it on, you've heard about it, on Facebook. So if you are a lecturer, please, or you are, that place of work is not the place to be committing such things. I always tell people, I thank God for the mentors that I had when I came into the university student. They sat me down, and then they told me, they said, if you need to do anything to earn money, you go to town. You don't do it here. Why? They say, don't do it. It's the medicine of don't hear it. Mashe, logumago. So if you do it, they will hear it. And the truth of the matter is that when you do it, people that you think you have done the favor for are the ones that will be publicizing your doing. I go and meet him. He did it for me. Meanwhile, you thought, so when he comes, he said, what are you talking about? I said, it's somebody that said it, then you know that you've been found out. So examination or practice can take any of those forms. Then what are the factors? The factors that, you know, that propel the examination or practice. When you look at it, the factor starts from, you know, parents. The root of examination or practice is from the parents. The root. One, parenting. Nowadays, not many people understand the principle of parenting. And some people, you can't blame them. They didn't come from a home. They don't know any model of parenting other than the one they are doing. So the parent factor is the primary factor in examination or practice. The home is the place where values are formed. I formed the habit of spending time with my children. They inherited my nature. They are all nocturnal people. They don't go to sleep early. So sometimes when I'm in my study, I'll come out and want to know what they are doing. And then we start talking. And sometimes I get so enthralled by what they are saying. Eh? You mean you know all this? Go and talk to your children. You'll be shocked what they know about you. And what they know going on in the world. If you don't befriend your children, other people will befriend them all. If you don't love them, all kinds of love is waiting for them. Genuine and fake love. If you don't keep their company, other people will keep their company. It is very common, particularly in Africa, to be praying that somebody else will not take your shine. So why is it that somebody else is taking your shine in parenting? It is not even the day of wedding. That one is advanced. If your share is being taken, the share has already gone. You are not there at home. The children wake up, they don't see you. They sleep, they don't see you. They eat, they don't see you. Weekends, they don't see you. You are an absentee father. You are a businesswoman. It's only, you know, the help and the people, the relations they are seeing. I pity you. Because at the end of the day, all your investment and all your work will be wasted. There are children who grow up, all the houses that you have, they are gone. I have people who have big houses. When we go to greet them, we say, let's be praying for these children. And what is the prayer? That they may come home. They are abroad. So all those things that are important, they are not important. There is a reason why God created children in the home.
have forgotten the role that they are supposed to play. The parent factor is the primary factor, is the key factor. In fact, the parent factor is the God factor. Because there, if there is any institution that God created for, you know, bringing up children, it's what? It's the home. In fact, that's why the only institution God created before he stopped having, you know, institutions with men is what? Is the home. Before man started blaming him, is that woman you gave me? God said, okay, from now, choose yourself. So the home, the parent factor cannot be overemphasized. Parents buy questions for their children. Am I lying? Parents approach JAMB, go to secondary school to give money to, you know, the teachers, to pass the children. Apart from the parent factor, we have the student factor. I tell you nowadays, it's not easy to engage the young ones. Because what is interesting to you is not probably interesting to them. In our days, we used to read a lot. In fact, it's the reading that I used to read that got me into law. I didn't want to do law. In fact, I wanted to be an aeronautical engineer. I like the sound of it. Aeronautical engineer. But I didn't have the capacity for engineering. It's like some parents will be calling their children Doki Kekere. Don't invest the Doki material in him. Okoma remain Doki Kekere in him. So please, the student factor, let's know the strength of our children. As a matter of fact, I was left alone to experiment. Thankfully, when we were growing up, there were no strictures about university admission. In fact, I was given admission in 3 universities, and I tried 2 of them before I settled down. I was given admission at University of Lagos. I went there. They gave me admission for BSADMIN, and I didn't do additional maths. We'll be in class. Somebody will be saying, DYDX, skinny angel. DYDX. What's that? You know? And before you could say Jack Robinson, somebody would say X is 2, Y is something. So if X is 2 and Y is 3, DYDX, the pro... Wrong class, Lily. You. I know God has wonders to perform in my life. Actually, I didn't. I went on, because University of Lagos calendar has always been better than that of Ife, even during my time. So they were a semester ahead of Ife. So when we had a mid-semester or something break, I went to Ife to join my friends, because most of my friends went to Ife. So my best friend was studying law, and I followed him to class. And everything they were saying resonated. It was just logical things to me. This law is interesting. And then they informed me that, did I not know that I was given admission for law? So I said, okay. So that's why I stayed and continued with that admission. And didn't go back to UNILAG to DYDX myself into oblivion. Imagine if there was no such opportunity. A lot of our young people are boxed in. They are boxed in into something that they don't want. And you will be sitting down there and be saying, give me a break. The brain is not a matter of force. It's a matter of will. Force your child into the wrong education, you are going to force him to cheat. So let's seek proper counsel. And that takes us to the teacher factor. Teachers, please, we need to really, really go the extra mile. I know it's not easy. And there are some times when it will be discouraging because it looks like if nobody appreciates you. But I tell you, God does. And one of the good things of being a teacher, People always say, why is that? People always say that the teacher's reward is in heaven. It's not only in heaven, he's even here on earth. One of the privileges of being a teacher is that your products will always speak for you. Ask my wife. Whenever we go out, she'll be saying, is there any place where they don't know you? Because the rapport that I have with my student, I cannot have a student in my class and he will see me and not want to greet me. Kilo fe fine. What was the meaning of that? So let's sow into the life of the children. Let's take, irrespective of whatever is the practice in your school, be different. Go out of your way to be different. And nowadays, in most of our schools, counselors are not even doing anything. Apology to my wife, she's a counselor. Counselors are not doing anything. A lot of schools don't have proper counseling for children. So, the teachers don't teach. There are lecturers that don't even know how to lecture. In fact, it is assumed that once you have a degree, you can lecture. It's a lie. I got to know how to speak and how to talk by mentoring. And the first time it happened to me, I rebelled against it. It was one of my teachers. He set up something outside, and he was engaged in training. So he invited me to be one of the facilitators. And in this institution, they will give you materials. So they gave me materials. So I just catched through the material like we normally do in the university system and came and spoke to the students. And they were wowed because of my oratory, you know, God. Spoke when you go instead of speaking law. So I was on my way out when he called me. He said, come, Oye, I need to talk to you. Then I said, what the crap do you think you are doing? What? So that was not, you are not in the university, and you better pay attention to these things. All those things that you people do in the university, in private sector, is not acceptable. Because they will assess you. And if the assessment doesn't match the material, you are doomed. They will tell you, we won't be able to use you here again. So I said, what do you mean? Unknown to me, all that prancing I was doing was recorded. He recorded me without my permission. I said, objection. He said, sit down. Objection. Was my teacher, so I had to sit down. He said, look at it. Look at this sector you taught. Look at the material. How much of the material did you bring in? Less than 30%. Look at this place. How much? And that was a process. And I sobered up. And I tell you, nobody can take that away from me. Because I was well processed and well taught. Now, in the university, we have young men that don't want to be mentored. They don't want to talk. In fact, they want to ride the car you are driving. They want to look the way you are looking. We used to look at our professors up there. Now, they want to brush you off the something. So you find out that there is a problem, even with the lecturers and the teachers. Why? Because this examination or practice mentality has carried into the teaching, you know. So you find, go to teaching. What is being taught? Are people really teaching? And are the people teaching qualified to teach? Are they trained? Are they going through the process of continued education to make them better teachers? I will have to rush because of time. Then you have the schools and institutions. There is a problem. There are some schools, there are some universities. I've been on accreditation to several universities as an NUC accreditator. I know what I'm talking about. If we are honest with ourselves, we will close down some universities. If I have my way, some things I don't put in the public. But the truth of the matter is that there are certain institutions that should be closed down. It's like a hospital. If an hospital is killing people, will you keep it open? No, the same thing with institutions. The person is damaging the brain of the person. Do you know that it's more dangerous to damage the brain of a person than even to damage the health of the person? Because Because with food and nourishment, you can get out of it. But a damaged brain, you don't even see it. And you wait and such a person becomes your president. America is undergoing that now. Telling you, damaged brain. Dangerously damaged brain. That man is a danger to the world. Better be praying. He wants a war. Can you imagine? For any cause, damage. And of course, I'm only using America as an example. Because in Nigeria, we have so many damaged brains in so many places. Plenty damage. Damage place. Damage heads. You know? I will not. You imagine them. All the places where the damages are. And you know, if a person's health is bad, probably he will die. But when a man's brain is damaged, or a woman's brain, he can be injurious to more people than himself. So our institutions, we need to do something about them. Do they even have the infrastructure? You go to some schools, you enter the place, the stench of human beings that will first hit you. You go to some schools, there are no labs. I can't imagine it. When I was in school, I was a chemistry student. And our chemistry lab was open 24/7. In fact, I almost damaged myself in trying to be an Isaac Newton. Sulfuric acid, nitric acid, all of a sudden, bwah! The guy don't even have access. When you say nitric acid, when was the last time a child saw nitric acid? Talk less of sulfuric acid. It's terrible. No institutions. And then we want to make scientists. Little wonder more and more of our children want to be musicians. Go need lab. You know? It's terrible. Then we have those whom we call stakeholders in the educational institution. Who are these stakeholders? The private sector. They provide alternative. And at the secondary school level, they are a factor to be reckoned with. They are the ones, private schools, there are some private schools, because of school fees, children will be promoted whether they pass or they fail. Now, in all these, seriously, when you are looking at the factors, another dangerous factor we have is our environment and socioeconomic factor. Who are our role models? In politics, in governance, even in church. Who are those people that we can hold out as role models? Who you can see their life, their integrity and all that. I thank God that my head of department, or former head of department, is the vice president of this nation. That tells you the kind of values in the environment in which I've worked. Because people believe that you can just become anything by any means necessary. There will be repercussion. The word of God says, what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and what? He loses his soul. The biggest problem of Nigeria is the poverty of soul. When your soul is poor, no material wealth can cure the poverty. And you see that what we need is not sometimes more money. Because the little you have can go far. There are nations that don't have as much as we do. And their education is much better. If you go to Ghana, well, let me confess, I was born in Ghana. Mr. Fancy Papa. So if you go to Ghana, you see the educational system there. There was a time we used to pride ourselves in looking for Ghanaian lesson teacher. Why not the Nigerian lesson teacher? Hello, Shay. So the environment of corruption is a factor. Now our government
is the biggest factor. At the local government level, at the state government level, at,
in fact, federal sometimes is better, a lot better in payment, in structure, and all that. When you go to state, you go to some places, there are no teachers. You know, those of us in the Southwest, let's consider ourselves lucky sometimes. I was talking with one of my brothers from Kogi State, and he said, please stop talking. That he went to his village, until now, three schools there, each one of them have one science student, one math teacher, one English teacher for the whole school. One lesson, each one. And here you have free primary education, you have all these things. But all those things are crumbling because of government. What's the government factor that we look at? Over-centralization. When you run a true federal system, in the 60s, we could talk about educational experiment in each region. As a matter of fact, the West had federal and state, you know, universities. The university I attended was a state university. It was a Western region-owned university, and it was a model. But now, we have JAMB that will jam you. We have NUC that doesn't, you know, see you. And we have all these things that are populated by people who have no business in education. The common way you want to move fast in that, go and get a degree in Islamic studies. Check it out. Become Minister of Education, quick, quick. You become the DG of NUC, quick, quick. What do you know about education? You are an Islamic scholar. So, look, we have problems in that area. The resources, the personnel, and the brain, they are in different directions. When the personnel don't have the brain, and the brain has to subject to the personnel will... It's not surprising we have brain drain. And related to this is the leadership factor. Unfortunately, the first PhD holder that became our president made nonsense of having education in leadership. Nonsense of it. Because we have always argued, it's because our leaders are not educated. And here we had I won't agree to that. So, the leadership has been poor. And where there is no leader, what will happen? Everybody suffers. We all, you know, go astray. So the leadership factor has doomed this nation. One, we had the leadership that was not educated in the military. The height of it was the Google man. Was supposed to be a driver and go no further. He became our head of state. And you could see his lack of education. He killed more people than anybody else. You know who I'm talking about. Damaged brain. He got there. He damaged a lot of people. It took prayers for him to eat the apple and not raise up again. Then we could have been using prayer for good and better and, you know, more glorious things. We boast about praying for a man to die. Did we need to? So the leadership question, what is the role that we are playing in the selection of leaders? More and more Christians have retreated from the leadership issue. And the other religion is concerned about the leadership issue. Look at Lagos State. Look at the whole of Southwest. Look at the whole of the Middle Belt. Look at the whole. There is something that we are not doing right. If we say that we represent a sizable population in these areas, it should be reflected in the leadership and the values of the state. Now, when we talk about examination malpractice, we look at what is the effect. What is the effect? What does it have? What impact does it, you know, have on
us as individuals and, you know, as a nation. The first thing is that the products that we are going to be having will be poor. When I was in school, nobody cared that much about the degree or class you came with. You just enjoyed reading. And it's very few people who had parents who understood the essence of the grades. And of course, those who are naturally gifted. A lot of people were okay with 2-2. Is that not so? It's all okay. And your 2-2 will open door to the highest level. I had a 2-2 from school. I've enjoyed scholarship from America. I've enjoyed sponsorship from innumerable, you know, organizations. It's the quality of education that is in you. In fact, I can tell you, and this is the experience of most Nigerians who have this kind of education. People will tend to ask you when you go abroad, why is it that your country is like this? Why can't you go and rule your country? Rule Nigeria. That's a different question altogether. You know, book doesn't concern you getting there. Because in those days, there was, in the Southwest then, there was one man that was determining who even been our governor. So, the first thing is the certification, the quality of the outputs, the quality of the products. A lot of people who come out of our universities can't put sentences together. In fact, some are very good. They can speak, but they cannot write. They speak fine English, but the first thing you notice, they are text writers. They write in text, social media language. All their writings will be in small letters. No capital letter, no comma, no full stop. That's how you know this generation. They don't know the proper noun. They don't know, just communicate in small letters. And then apart from the products, you start to see that what is coming out to the labor market, the labor market becomes, it has to invest more to train people to be ready. Unfortunately, our curriculum doesn't help. I can use law, for example. The law curriculum is being revised. Why? Because the end users of our products are not finding our products suitable. You know, law was designed by the colonial master to serve the administration. But law is supposed to function as a service provider. So imagine if law is being taught for administration, as opposed to law as a service provider, the paradigms are different. If you are training lawyers for service provision, you will train them in what we call the lawyering skills. Not just knowing how to pass exams. So we have challenges in the labor market with the products that we have. And then, of course, it affects the quality of your leadership, which we have talked about. The fact that somebody has gone to school is no guarantee that he can deliver. Why? You don't know how he acquired his degree, particularly our politicians. It's so bad that people can't even produce school certificate to show that they went to school. Even this present president. What's going on? When a president cannot flash his degree and say, bam, it should not be a subject of dispute at all. We have problem in the leadership when examination or practice takes over the system. And of course, you have the wrong reward system that will discourage the really intelligent student. When you put in all your efforts and somebody that you know that cannot on its own self come up with an idea is getting A. And the person who really knows the thing is not getting the A. What happens? The person gets frustrated. I don't know why. And then
our product outside, we become a laughing stock. I had to beg my son that whatever you do, make sure that you get above 4.0. Because I know I'm in the system. There are certain universities all over the world. If you don't get above 4.0, they won't consider your child for a master's degree. It's that bad. In those days, 2.2 was good enough. It's not enough for you to have a 2.1. You must now also have above 4.0. And there are so many law firms that won't take a look at you if you don't have 4.0. What has happened to us? So now, apart from that, you now have qualifying exam of 5 stages. Kilo day. Qualifying exam stage 1, qualifying exam stage 2, because you want to weed out all the chaff that has come out of the system. So all this is wastage of resources. Our resources will be going into all these things that are not, you know. So we waste resources in being, so a lot of our resources are wasted. And, of course, what it means is that the level of ignorance and illiteracy in the community is not diminishing, it's increasing. Why? It's better that somebody doesn't know, and he knows that he doesn't know, than for somebody to think that he knows when he doesn't know. Half knowledge is the most dangerous kind of knowledge. And we have half knowledge all over in our places. And that becomes a problem for us. So, what that will lead to, the nation will not move forward. Economic growth becomes, we go backwards. And then, of course, we have social unrest. Is it not manifesting? It's everywhere. You have crime rates very high. You have people coming out of university, and the thing they want to do is Yahoo Yahoo business. If you are Yahoo Yahoo in here, you are in the house of God. You need to repent. You need to repent. So, social unrest, and of course, destruction of lives and property, and the threat of war. You start people, you know. There's a reason why some sections of the community in Nigeria don't want their people to be educated. Because they want to be interpreting to them and be misinterpreting to them so that they can be used as instruments of violence. If we are educated, we'll be less prone to violence than we are. All this has impact on the educational standards. So what do we mean by educational standards? Now, when you talk about educational standard, it's a level of proficiency that is expected for you to bring out a certain outcome. So when you say that your educational standard is high, it means that the quality of those people will be able to bear the representation of their certificates. So if you say somebody is a degree holder, there are certain skills that comes with it. And that's why when we go abroad, you find out that, look, truth be told, our educational standard, we have the IQ, but the training that we have received doesn't match what we are supposed to do. There are simple things that people are supposed to do that they don't know how to do it. How to write a memo, what is different between a memo, opinion, all those little things. You just find out that our students, they don't know how to do these things. So when you talk about educational standards, we are talking about the process by which the needs of the country is met through the process of education. And I've referred to the National Policy on Education and the philosophy behind the educational standards that we have. Now, we have education from all levels, from the day you are born. Is that not so? The day you are born, your education starts from the house, from the home. You go to preschool, you go to nursery school, you go to school, primary school, and
then you go to JS1, and that's basic education. Under the basic, universal basic education law, basic education in Nigeria is compulsory. But interestingly, the legislators in Nigeria don't want Nigerians to have the right to education. There's a difference between making basic education compulsory. If you say you have made basic education compulsory, then give me the right to education. So which becomes that I can compel you to set the standard. It can be reducible, measurable, and I can call experts to say that, look, this is the basic education that I should get. Then you will now explain to me why there is no resources to do it. And then it becomes a matter of, okay, if there's no resources, this will be the minimum. I got to know this because I worked with the National Assembly on the Constitution Amendment process with the 7th Assembly, not this current Assembly. And, you know, in Nigeria, we have civil and political rights, and we have economic and social rights, which are not justiciable. So we wanted to take right to education, right to health, right to housing, and of course, right to a reasonable standard of living. All of them, they pushed them out. All. Because they said, where is the money? And I asked myself, where is the money? Each senator, in the 4 years that I spent there, we spent nothing less than $4 billion on a senator. Yes. Yes. On a senator's one time, it's $1 billion per term. $1 billion. Go and find out. They will not tell you the written. They will tell you basic. But all the bulletproof cars and all that, who is paying for it? We are. So if they are spending 4 billion naira on you, imagine how much will be the cost of basic, real basic education that I cannot go around to more people for the betterment of. So the question is, who are you representing? Our president has fleet of planes, can even park some and be paying foreign exchange. We should have a right to make sure that our resources are compelled to be spent in a way that will touch our life. Give us the right to education, not the policy of education for all, and not the policy of feeding people with masa and eko and akamu, messy things. Quality education can be determined. So the minimum that we need, if we really want right a standard of education that will take us to the future, let's put our mouth where our money where our mouth is, and give every Nigerian right to basic education. No more. After basic, you know, our father's day, they had basic education, standard 6. They could write. Is that not so? That's what we are asking for. Not this basic education that somebody goes through basic education, he can't even write his name. And that same person will become a PAMSEC. And there will be a special person from another place who will be doing the work for him. Special advisor. So, standard education, we need to address it both in terms of law and in terms of resources. And then when we talk about standard of education, what is the principle that we have in Nigeria? I've said it. We have basic education, 9 years. Secondary education, 3 years, and university education, how many years? 4 years, minimum. You see that in this policy, there is no address of the needs other than the person who is going to university. What about the person that wants to go to technical? What about the person who wants to engage in skills acquisition, entrepreneuring, business? There is no provision. And then they will say they should go and teach some courses one by one. Give me a break. That will not do. We should design a policy for the future. Seriously, as far as I'm concerned,
even the current national policy on education has no relationship with modern needs of the country Nigeria. Go to every industry, go to the oil industry, go to the every industry that requires technical people, we don't have them. Why? Because we have shut down our technical institutions. And I tell you, apart from the certification of being a graduate, technical people abroad earn much more than you that you are a graduate. So why are we disdaining the thing other than, oh, it's a messy job? Messy? He will put more on the table than you that you are doing Thai every day. And Ogasa, Ogasa. We need to change our orientation. Then apart from that, when you look at the standard of education and the quality of education in examination, what is the means by which we examine our students? What is the means? Now it's been found out that when we bring in other means of testing students, cheating goes down. You know, you use continuous assessment. You use other interactive process of assessing students, which makes them comfortable, and which will really will test their IQ instead of the Agberu, Agbeso system that we have. You know? So we need to really interact with the policy that we are going through. Now, how do we combat examination malpractice? How? The first thing we need is value education. We need to teach people about values. Parents need to know about values. You know, without values, people become people who are lacking in control. And I see it that a lot of young people nowadays, the problem they have is the problem of lack of self-control and discipline. Because they don't have values. And why? The parents did not convey the value system to them. So we need to have values. If we don't have values, we'll be destroyed. And one of the things that African countries are known for, African societies are known for, before now, that things have gone bad, is values. You know, the Bible says that a good name is better than what? Silver and gold. It's there in our culture. We need to reorientate ourselves as parents, as students, values. And you know, the value system that we have is always profitable. Profitable. When my resume was being read, it was stated that I'm a partner in a law firm. I had the privilege of working with one young man in the Ministry of Justice, in the Department of Civil Litigation. And he went on to set up a law practice. And then one day, his head of, you know, civil litigation relocated. And they had some cases. And then he called me out of the blues. He said, can I come? So I went to meet him. He said, you know, I always remembered I enjoyed your interaction. You know, and now that you're a believer, I'm a believer, let's see what we can do together. That was like more than 20 years ago. He still remembered the common values that we shared, even though both of us had not given our life to Christ at that time. But we had values. We did things according to the values that was fair. There was no cheating. Values is like in the corporate world, you have what you call corporate governance. Companies that employ corporate governance, they stand the test of time. For a human being, you must have values. If your core values are wrong, your life is wrong. So we cannot overemphasize the need for values. We need to return back to the basics. In the homes, there must be values. In the church, there must be values. Wherever we are as a society, there must be what? Values. When people have values, they will check themselves.
They will not throw themselves at anything. And that is why the Bible says, my son, when the sinners entice you, you know what? Not consent. Sorry, sometimes I enjoy the vernacular interpretation of things. The Rabbi will say, oh, mommy, be a lesson banter. You want my shit, bah. His values, bah. It's the values. If there is nothing that the person can use to resist the enticement, what will happen? You go with it. We cannot overemphasize values. We need to have values. And then, of course, we need to have our student motivated. Look, motivation can work even when you don't intend it. I remember when one of my sons, my last child, when he had to enter university, he had become a prayer point for us. Because he was, I would say he was more like me before I came to know the Lord. So of course he posed the challenges that I posed to my dad. So I was praying and all that about his exams. And one day I just sat down with him. I said, don't you want to do this thing? He said, well, I want to do it. I said, okay. So I had plan A, plan B, and plan C, which was because of my knowledge of the university. Well, he'll go through JAMB. If he doesn't pass the JAMB, he'll go through our diploma. And if he doesn't pass our diploma, he'll go and do A-levels. Then he said, so what's the difference? So I explained it. So I said, you know what? If you go through this JAMB, you'll save me a lot of money. Because diploma will cost me this much. But I tell you, if you save me that money, you know I'm a fiat dad. That money will share it 50-50. Because we were planning to go to London. So I said, if you just do that, you come along. And you just spend the money yourself. And we spoke. And when his school start result came, I felt, okay, let's start intensifying our efforts for diploma. And you know what? God is wonderful. He misfilled the diploma form. He filled one column that he was not supposed to fill, and in UNILAG, the result was not released. So the mom was like, what will we do? And interestingly, at that time, I was the dean of the faculty. So a lot of people were interested in how I would solve that problem. This man that is always boasting about integrity. So I started praying that God make a way, because this one now looks like if there's no way. And my joy knew no bounds when that young man killed plan A and got through on his merits without me even having to lift a finger. And when we were talking and I was asking him, but you didn't look serious, said daddy, it's you now, you are looking at surface. You are looking at surface. Me, I wanted to go to London, so I'm going to London. Oh. We need to find the way to know our children, to motivate them. Motivate your children and they will surpass your expectation. Because the truth of the matter is that that young man has continued to surpass my expectation. Now, we talk about proper training and equipping of teachers. We cannot overemphasize that. When we enter the university, Professor Otinwa is here to validate what I'm saying. We had fund for you to attend conference. Is that not so? And as God will have it, if you are smart enough to attend identify the relevant conferences, the university will what? Sponsor it. Now that fund has dried up. So the young people who are coming now, they don't have the exposure that going abroad and interacting with your peers will have on you. So we need to create, that will take us to the problem of funding. And then, of course, evolve effective sanctions. We must have sanctions. When there is no sanctions, the psychology principle of reinforcement of evil comes into play. When somebody does something, you don't catch him, it becomes the norm. Is that not so? And before you know it, without sanction, we become enmeshed in examination malpractice. So sanction is very, very important. And then, of course, proper monitoring. We need to monitor examination. Please, if you are given responsibility for examination, don't delegate. I found that out 1 year when there was a leakage. And I had this principle about exam. There is not much that can throw you into controversy like exam as a university lecturer. Anything goes wrong with the exam, everybody will step back on you. It can destroy you. So I had a dean who was very fussy. And he said, we must give him questions some weeks before the exam. And that was against my policy. So I went to him, I told him, I will only give you the exam 48 hours to the time. He said, not on your something, that you will be responsible for the exam. And I said, yes, I'll be responsible for it. Then I took my money, I made photocopy of all the exams. And guess what? Most of the exam that passed through him was leaked by people working under him. He had to be buried. But he called me, he said, did you have an idea about this thing? I said, no. It's just that I have a policy that I don't trust people working in the dean's office. Because they can compromise you. Students know that they have that power. They have access. So we need to monitor, you know. We need to have ICT. You can see that examination or practice in JAMB is coming down with this ICT system they are running. It can work. We can even introduce biometrics. I was invited to Bayes University in Abuja to advise them in their law and all that. And they took me to their examination center. When they are writing exams, all students write exams at the same time. Law students, education students, they will all come into the exam room and they will just sit them anyhow. They will just ask you, oh, yeah, come in. Don't sit there. And then as they are coming in, biometrics, they are taking their fingerprints. And what really impressed me was that every row has ICT. Looking at them, closed circuit monitoring. And there are invigilators in the hall, and there are also invigilators monitoring the monitor. So of course, when you go to that hall, it speaks volume about the preparation of the students. You see the ones that read the question, look to the left, look to the right, put it down, and sleep. Go ban here. No attempt at cheating. Because if you do it, you'll be caught. In fact, if you don't have CCTV, you can use your alumni association. I was amazed. One of the last exams I wrote was to write exam for the state of California to become a lawyer there. And I was lucky to be interning in a law firm. And on the day, the week I was taking my leave, the partners called me and they were advising me. And they kept on coming back to one advice. Say, Oye, we know you from Nigeria. When they say pens up, it means pens up, you know. They said, when they say pens up, and they kept on saying, when I got to the exam room, I knew why. They brought retired lawyers to come and invigilate. You see these people over 60, all of them over 60, retiring and ready to protect the profession. When you do her like this, two of them, in fact, it's like they have like two to a student or something. They are even almost much more because they have to be using the restroom. So it's a rotational, you know, at that age. C
see them talking, they come in, they go. It's either you knew it, and of course, it wasn't CCTV, but as the exam was progressing, you just see people dead, out, dead, out, dead. There's no cheating. So we need this idea of having one invigilator to 300 students. It's not going to work. We need to get the alumni involved, but we need to know which alumni too, that they don't bring their virus. Because if you bring cheating alumni, it will be CNN. So we need to also fund proper funding of education. I've spoken about this. Governments need to commit money. I'll show you statistics about our funding. This current funding, the percentage to education is 6%. That's when ASUU strike, and people are saying, why is ASUU striking? Why will ASUU not strike? When there is more money devoted to the toilet of the vice president or the president than university. When the T of photocopier in one ministry is much more than what a university will spend in 10 years. And they've been buying the same photocopying machine for the same for the 12 years. They should even bring some of them to the university after they've used it for 1 year. So funding, proper funding. We need to have proper funding. And then, of course, we need to formulate and implement an effective education policy. All these dongonturenchi that we do, power, sir. It's just an exercise in futility. Please, when you go home, Google and bring out the 2013 National Policy on Education. You read it and you'll be wondering, is this for Nigeria? It's not real. It's an administrative exercise to fulfill a deliverable. And those people are there. They just use that make money. We need to talk to ourselves. Please go to the next slide and so that I can quickly conclude. My time is fast spent. So when we look at, I want to spend some bit of time on funding. Because funding is key. When you look at funding, I am talking about funding not only at federal government, at state level, at local government level. Funding is poor. Funding is poor. What is the benchmark, minimum benchmark of funding recommended by UNDP? 26%. Where is the remaining 20% when we are achieving 6%? 26%. And out of this 26%, Nigeria has not even come as high as 13%. Never. The highest we have come is 11%. As way back. So we need to have, you know, funding. Now, in making recommendations, there are several recommendations that one can make to, you know, deal with. But I wanted to you know, not to try to reinvent the wheel. Because there is a recommendation that is at the national level. And that's the recommendation of the National Conference of 2014. The recommendation of the National Conference of 2014. Go to the next slide. I've gone beyond this. The National Conference of 2014 made several recommendations, and they have all addressed all the issues I've raised. Education must function to be education if we mean education. We cannot pretend at education. Because we cannot, through our pretense, get an educated person. So when we pretend, we are not getting educated people. We are getting something else other than education. And we talk about reform in education. These recommendations are the minimum reducible recommendation one can make. So that when we look in the next 57 years, come, we can see a transformation.
When they came, this man said he came to Nigeria the first time before independence. And they came, I think it was 1956 to 1958. They did a study at the potentials of Nigeria. And they made certain observations that we have potentials. We have population, but we are lacking in infrastructure. We have intelligence, but we are lacking in institutions. In fact, we have the raw materials, but we don't have the institutions for research and development. But because we have oil, they had hope that we'll get our act together. In 2017, as we celebrate the Independence Day of this country, the simple question we have to ask, what is the verdict? For me, the verdict is out. If I have to grade this country, I will not give it a pass mark. With respect to education, we need to do more. My personal conviction is that an emergency should be declared in that sector. Because what is going on in the educational sector, if it is not addressed, this nation